House will come back to order. The House will be in order. All members will report to the floor of the House and take seats. I'll ask the clerk to ring the bell. All members, we're back in session. Hope everyone had a good lunch. I'm going to ask the clerk to read the caption to a group of privileged resolutions.
Resolution Representative Abrams, 89th, congratulating the International Association of Machinists and Aerospace Workers on the occasion of its 125th anniversary. Resolution Representative Bryant, 162nd. Recognizing and commending Mrs. Louise Baxter for her loyal, faithful service to the Fairlawn Baptist Church, Garden City Community. Resolution for Representative Glanton, the 75th, commending the 3rd Battalion, 320th Field Artillery Regiment, 3rd Brigade Combat Team, and the 101st Airborne Division Air Assault, and recognizing the leadership of Lieutenant Colonel Shannon Majowski and Commanding Sergeant Robert Robles. Resolution for Representative Neal II, recognizing and commending Mr. Stan Cooper on his retirement. Resolution for Representative Scott, 76th, commending Mr. Samuel Bryant, Mara Middle School's 2012-2013 Teacher of the Year. Resolution by Representative Martin, 49th, honoring the life and memory of Representative Clay Ford. Resolution for Representative Oliver, 82nd, recognizing and commending Shamley Charter High School, Shamley Middle School, outstanding achievements, German language, instruction and learning. Resolution for Representative Lumsden, 12th, commending Joseph Eli Dutton, Chattooga High School's 2013 Star Student. Resolution for Representative Lumsden, 12th, commending Jacob Allen Reeves, Tryon High School's 2013 Star Student, through the privilege resolutions.
Is there objection to the adoption of the privilege resolutions? The chair hears none, and the resolutions are adopted. Chair recognizes. We are back in session. Members will be seated if they're in the chamber and give attention to the members in the well. Chair recognizes Chairman Dixon for a motion.
Move that the House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 115.
Chairman Dixon has moved that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 115. The clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 115, Representative Dixon of the 6th, bill to be entitled Act Title 20 relating to local boards of education. In your agree, disagree folders, you will find a Senate passed version of this House Bill 115. It's L upper right hand corner, LC335170S, together with the House passed version. Agreement to the Senate substitute constitutes final passage of this bill.
Chair recognizes Chairman Dixon to explain his motion.
Members of the House, there's three changes to the bill as we sent it over there. The first is on line 20 and very simply says that the local school system will have to notify the state board in writing when they come under the accreditation issue. And then over on line 82, they added language which would preclude a local school system from using public funds to pay attorney's fees for any litigation, but that would commence once the state board had made a recommendation for removal of board members. And then section 2 of the bill has the language which would allow students in a system that loses their accreditation during the next 2 years to still be HOPE eligible. If there are any questions, we'd like to answer those. Otherwise, that is the differences in the bill.
You have a question if you care to yield.
Yes, sir.
Chair recognizes Representative Morgan to your left for a question.
Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Chairman, would you remind me what the original purpose of the bill was?
Yes. The original purpose of the bill was to do a relatively simple thing, which was allowing the state board to deliberate in private after they had the open hearing. And it also had the protection for board members who were on a board of education but were elected after the accreditation had been changed. Those were the two major things before. Those are both still in the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You have no further questions.
I yield the well. Thank you.
Gentleman has yielded the well on the gentleman's motion that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 115. All those in favor will vote yes, those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines on the gentleman's motion. The ayes are 122, the nays are 45. This House has agreed to the Senate substitute to House Bill 115. Going back to the rules calendar here for just a bit. The clerk will read the caption to Senate Bill 104. Senate Bill 104.
Senate Bill 104 by Senator Ginn of the 47th, a bill to be entitled Act Title 50, relating to the Department of Community Affairs so as to revise the minimum elements addressed and included in comprehensive plans of local governments, to remove the requirement for certain findings with regard to projects of regional importance or impact, to remove certain limitations on actions by counties, municipalities with regard to local plans. Bill hadn't been for the House Committee on Governmental Affairs. Committee recommends that this bill do pass. Bill's being read for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Powell to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and ladies and gentlemen, I bring to you this afternoon SB 104. This deals with local comprehensive planning changes. The history behind this is that comprehensive plans were developed by Georgia's cities and counties a series of years ago, so that cities and counties had to develop their strategic plans once every 10 years and then renew it every 5 years. A couple of years ago, Senate Bill 86 had passed, dealt with trying to eliminate a lot of the costly paperwork that was being generated by these cities and counties having to hire a lot of these high-priced consultants in the development of these plans. The bill passed, did not make it through the whole process. The Department of Community Affairs that handles these plans had met, they had developed a planning rules task force to try to eliminate a lot of these unnecessary rules and regulations, and that was adopted. As a result of that two-year process between the DCA, ACCG, GMA, and a lot of other groups, they have came forth with a proposal that there were three parts that needed to be legislatively changed, and that's what this bill does. One is it makes it optional for the local governments in planning for housing, human services, and the such, so that that paperwork would then be eliminated from the regional commissions. Second part of this, it does not require the regional commissions to issue a public finding. It's not also necessary, has no effect, but what those public findings tend to do is stir up and generate a lot of controversy between those local governments. And a note, special note to that is that the regional commission still conduct an analysis and report on the impacts of the proposed development of regional impact, the DIRs, which is shared and then shared within that neighborhood of communities. And the third change is it changes the deadlines on when these local governments must adopt a comprehensive plan and when to submit it to the regional commissions. The change, which is a deletion, is that they can go ahead and adopt the plan rather than waiting the 60 days, which they could do anyway. That, ladies and gentlemen, is what this does. This is supported by DCA, has passed the Senate. You will note there's a couple of amendments that have been offered to this. I'll address the amendments. The first amendment by Stevens, we looked at it, has no impact, really not needed, but for somebody out there, they're going to be able to say that they were able to amend the bill that creates some level of transparency, so have no objections to that. There's a second amendment by Representative Welch, which, as I understand, was a language in House Bill 35 that passed earlier in the session, went through the House, went through the Senate, got hung up in the Senate rules. So this is a Christmas tree ornament that'll be put on the back of this. And if you ask me any questions about it, I'll stumble through the answers on House Bill 35. And if not, Mr. Welch may wish to come up here and address his amendment. And I'll be more than glad to. In talking with GMA and ACCG, they overwhelmingly welcome that amendment. Mr. Speaker, I'll be glad to answer any questions if there are any.
There are none.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. There are two amendments. There are two amendments. The first is the Stevens Amendment. It is AM 281263. Is there objection to the adoption of the Stevens Amendment? Hearing none, that amendment is adopted. The next amendment is the Welch Amendment. It is AM 292184. What purpose does Representative Setzler rise?
Parliamentary inquiry, Mr. Speaker.
State your inquiry.
Is there a way we could posture through parliamentary inquiry to understand what the AM 292184 does? I'm not clear on the effect of the amendment, and the author of the bill wasn't too detailed about it.
Well, we can do that, but the chair has a thinks there's more threshold issue involved than what it does. And I'm going to rule it non-germane. So we've adopted the Stevens Amendment. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of Senate Bill 104 will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no. And the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of Senate Bill 104. The ayes are 169. The nays are 7. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption of Senate Bill 242. Senate Bill 242.
Senate Bill 242 by Senator Hill of the 6th. Bill to be entitled Act Amending Code Section 3642A, relating to powers of Downtown Development Authorities generally so as to provide that Downtown Development Authorities may undertake projects reducing energy or water consumption on property or installing improvements on the property that produces energy from renewable resources. Bill has been before the House Committee, Energy, Utilities, and Telecommunications. Committee recommends that this bill do pass. Bill's being read today for its third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Martin to explain the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, Senate Bill 242 adds a very simple piece of language down at the bottom. I hope I got your attention with that simple piece of language. Lines 24 and 25 to extend to the entire municipality limits the Downtown Development Authority's ability to finance projects for clean energy. It's called the PACE program. This is not an extension of what is able to be done, but is an extension of where it can be done. So a Downtown Development Authority can now do this within the boundaries of the municipal authority that created them. Mr. Speaker, if there are no questions, I yield the well and ask the House's favorable consideration of Senate Bill 242.
No questions.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The gentleman has yielded the well. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bill? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of Senate Bill 242 will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no. And the clerk will unlock the machine. What purpose does Representative Quick rise?
Mr. Speaker, in accordance with Rule 133, I ask to be excused from the vote.
The lady has that right, and the journal will so reflect. She has invoked the Chokas rule. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines on the passage of Senate Bill 242. The ayes are 165, the nays are 3. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Chair recognizes Representative Tanner for a motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 122.
Representative Tanner has moved that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 122. The clerk will read the caption. You want to restate the motion, Representative? I didn't catch it either.
Yes, sir. I move that this House agree to the Senate amendment to House Bill 122.
Okay. Representative Tanner has moved that this House agree to the Senate amendment to House Bill 122. The clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 122, by Representative Tanner of the 9th, bill being titled an act relating to risk assessment classification as a sexually dangerous predator. The House passed version of House Bill 122 is in your agree disagree folders, upper right hand corner, LC 295438S. The Senate amendment is Senate amendment to House Bill 122. The Senate amendment, and again in your agree disagree folders, is upper right hand corner, AM 292181. Read the Senate amendment on this bill constitutes final passage.
Chair recognizes Representative Tanner to explain the Senate amendment. Just a minute, Representative. House will be at order. The chair can hardly hear the clerk, and I suspect that some of you might wish to hear the presentation and any questions or debate. Proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Senate amendment, originally House Bill 122 addresses items that were classified as state secrets and who has access to them. The original version discussed allowing the Sex Offender Registration Review Board to have access to certain items that were classified as state secrets that were held by the parole board. In addition, the Senate amendment will protect additional information as state secrets, specifically relating to the execution process carried out by the state, the identifying information of those individuals that participate in or administer the execution of the death sentence, including the identifying information of the individuals and companies, would be protected. This is necessary in order to protect the safety of the individuals that have been in the past threatened and retaliated against because of their willingness to assist in the state in carrying out a court order mandate. I am not here to argue in favor or against the death penalty. However, I do feel that the state has an obligation to protect individuals that are involved in this process. Many people would like for this bill to be about just protecting big business, but the reality is many of the people involved in this process are correctional guards, doctors that have their practices here in Georgia, and others that make their living here in the state of Georgia. Other states have already taken action to ensure this protection. 14 out of the 34 states that currently have the death penalty have already enacted some type of protection for these individuals. With that, Mr. Speaker, I would ask for favorable consideration for the Senate amendment to House Bill 122.
You have some questions.
I'll yield.
Just a moment. Now, we have an important subject here before this body. The chair is going to insist on order and respect to the members in the well and the members asking questions. Chair recognizes the minority leader of the House, Representative Abrams, for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Will the gentleman yield?
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Tanner, I supported the underlying bill, but can I draw your attention to the Senate Amendment line 17 through 19.
Yes, ma'am.
Certainly line 16 and 17, I think, make sense that we would remove and redact the identifying information and keep confidential the identifying information of anyone who participates in the execution of a death sentence because that person is operating under the color of law. But can you speak to the reason we would keep secret the identifying information for the drugs that are used, given that there has been a number of occasions, both in this state and in other states, where there have been unlawful uses of these drugs. Why would we prevent the public from having access to this information in order to secure justice?
Yes, ma'am. I'd be glad to answer that. The manner that the sentence is carried out, the type of drug that's used would not be protected, but the individual who's supplying that or manufacturing it would be. There's been several court cases on target to this, all the way up to the Supreme Court, relating to not being able to make that a standard and seeking an appeal for the death sentence. The purpose of this is these companies are very reluctant to participate in this process because of the level of harassment and threats that they're faced with. So, and again, there's other opportunities to be able to provide these medications here in Georgia through compounding pharmacies and other providers, but these individuals are not going to participate in that if we're not able to offer some level of protection to them.
Would you further yield?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you speak to the line 21? You said that it would be precluded, but does this not say that it would be precluded under judicial process? Would we be eliminating the ability of a judge to inquire into this, or are we simply trying to restrict her from public access?
This would restrict the access of that information from access by the public and through the judicial process. And again, there's on target court cases specifically addressing this issue, some out of the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals out of California, which typically seems to be the most left liberal leaning court in the country, that specifically has ruled that this is not an issue. And no federal court case in the country has deemed the origin of these drugs a question for the court.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You have additional questions?
I'll take another question, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Representative Oliver to your left for a question.
Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it not true, sir, that I agree with the minority leader that the identity of the individuals who are acting to carry out the execution should be confidential? But isn't it further true that there's active litigation which affects the length of death penalty litigation on the cocktails to implement an execution and on the identity of the medical doctors? Isn't that true, sir, in Georgia?
If the lady so states, I'm sure she believes that to be so.
And if I am correct about that, sir, isn't it also true that if I vote for 122, that I will be lengthening the litigation further, the painful litigation for every victim's family, if we change the cocktail, if we change the implementation strategy, and if we make all of that secret and not open to inquiry by either the court or the defense lawyers, that will in fact lengthen the litigation? Isn't that, sir, true, sir?
That would be a matter of an opinion. I would disagree with that statement, but I'm sure that you believe it to be so.
One final question, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Isn't it also true that the American Medical Association has deemed it a violation of the Code of Medical Ethics to participate in executions, and therefore that is a further issue of litigation that you are lengthening by virtue of 122 amendment?
Again, I would disagree with that statement, but I'm sure you believe it to be so.
Do you yield for another question or two?
I'll take one more, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes the Majority Caucus Whip, Representative Lindsay, to your right for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Will the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
Is it not true that all the bill does is require that if there is a judicial process, that the information that's revealed through that judicial process shall not be made public?
That's correct, sir.
Is it not also true that this is often the case in lawsuits of both civil and criminal nature, where there is a state secret involved, the parties and the court is required to seal certain information because of the fact that certain information may either be a state secret or a corporate secret worthy of confidentiality?
That is true, yes, sir.
It's not true that this bill basically will assist us in moving forward with our established public policy in the state of Georgia, which is favoring the use of the death penalty when appropriate?
Yes, sir, that is extremely correct.
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, with that, I'll yield the well and ask for favorable consideration for the amendment to Senate amendment to House Bill 122.
Gentleman has yielded the well on the gentleman's motion that this House agree to the Senate amendment to House Bill 122. All those in favor will vote yes, those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? Have all members now voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the adoption of the amendment or the agreement of on the gentleman's motion that this House agree to the Senate amendment to House Bill 122. The ayes are 117, the nays are 60, the House has agreed. Chair recognizes Representative Clark for a motion.
Mr. Speaker and ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. I move the House agree to Senate substitute to House Bill 131.
Representative Clark has moved that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 131. The clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 131, Representative Clark, 101st. Bill will be entitled Amendment Title 20 relating to educational programs. In your agree, disagree folders, the House passed version of this bill, House Bill 131, upper right hand corner, LC 410074S. The Senate substitute, which is subject to Representative Clark's motion. Senate substitute, upper right-hand corner, LC410090S.
Chair recognizes Representative Clark to explain her motion.
Again, thank you, Mr. Speaker and ladies and gentlemen. House Bill 131 gives the same advantage to students in dual enrollment as those who are in advanced placement classes for calculation of the HOPE scholarship. The Senate committee removed lines 71 through 74, which were added in House committee. Removal of the amendment would allow the bill to consider only dual enrollment students at this time. The governor's advisors and the Georgia Student Finance Commission would like to assess the fiscal impact before increasing the scope of the bill, and I ask for your favorable consideration of the Senate substitute to House Bill 131. And Mr.
Speaker, you have no questions.
Yes, sir.
You have no questions. The lady has yielded the well.
Thank you, sir.
On the lady's motion that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 131, all those in favor will vote aye, those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the lady's motion that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 131, the ayes are 174, the nays are 1. This House has agreed. Well, without commenting on the motion or the bill, the chair sure is glad to recognize Representative Jay Powell for a motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that this House agree to Senate substitute to House Bill 197.
Chairman Powell has moved that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 197. The clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 197, Representative Powell, 171st. The bill will be entitled Amendment Title 48, relating to ad valorem taxation of property. In your agree, disagree folders, you will find the House passed version of House Bill 197, upper right hand corner, LC 343796S, and the Senate substitute, House Bill 197, which is subject to Representative Powell's motion, upper right hand corner, LC 343869S, Senate substitute on House Bill 197.
Chair recognizes Chairman Powell to explain his motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, there are three basic changes that were made by the Senate in line 16 and line 45. There's a change in line 16 to CUVA, which is a conservation use value assessment, valuation assessment. And in line 45, the same change is made to this that just makes it clear that just because property is not used for profit, as long as it's used for genuine conservation purpose, that because it's not for profit doesn't discontinue its use under a covenant. And then in line 262, we had a penalty in here that for counties that abuse the system or game the system, that they could lose the grant for that particular year. And what the Senate did was they did not want a Board of Education to be punished because of tax assessor or the tax board's abuse of the process. And so we excluded the portion of the grant attributable to the Board of Education. And then finally on line 308 and 331, we had changed the interest that's paid after there is a successful or unsuccessful appeal. And there was no mechanism for how that interest was to be computed. And so we just put a computation provision in there. And Mr. Speaker, I'll be happy to answer any questions. Otherwise, I'll yield the well and request favorable consideration.
Well, you have a question if you care to yield. It's up to you.
I will answer a question.
Chair recognizes the chairman of the Transportation Committee to your right, Chairman Roberts, for a question.
Friendly type question. Gentleman, yield?
Yes.
Representative, in line 16 through 19, and I follow what you're trying to do, but can you give me an example of what you're referring to there?
There have been situations where people are in, they like to look at trees as opposed to cut them and harvest them, but they're still doing the same thing, whether it's carbon sequestration or improving the environment or whatever it may be. But there have been instances where you've got 159 counties and you've got 159 different interpretations. And so there have been some interpretations that this wouldn't be covered.
Further yield. So this just clarifies to the counties exactly what we've been trying to tell them over the years.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Mr. Speaker, I will yield the well.
Gentleman has yielded the well. On the gentleman's motion that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 197, all those in favor will vote yes. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the gentleman's motion, the ayes are 175. The nays are 1. This House has agreed to the Senate substitute, House Bill 197. Chair recognizes Chairman Cooper for a motion. Chairman Cooper, just, Madam Chair, hold on just a moment. We are still in session. Chair will ask that you clear the aisles of traffic and take your conversations outside. We're taking up important measures that require a little reading and some listening. Chair recognizes Chairman Cooper to proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that the House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 315.
Chairman Cooper has moved that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 315. The clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 315, Representative Cooper of the 43rd, a bill of entitlement Title 43 relating to registered professional nurses. House version of the House Bill 315 is printed in your agree disagree folders. Senate substitute to House Bill 315, also in your folders. Senate substitute to House Bill 315, upper right hand corner, HB 315/SCSFA/2, numerical 2.
Chair recognizes Chairman Cooper to explain her motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Senate, in this substitute, put together two House bills that had passed this House. One to require continuing education for registered nurses and licensed practical nurses. And the other was to require, when we have the funds available, mandatory reporting of nurses that are addicted to alcohol or drugs or make serious mistakes that endanger the lives of Georgia patients. They also added an amendment that helps tourism, but it is related to the medical field in that it's massage therapists that are regulated under the same code. Down on our coast during their busiest time, there seems to be a shortage of massage therapists. And this would allow for a provisional license for out-of-state massage therapists to come into our state and work for 6 months if they meet all the requirements listed in this bill. They have no prior legal problems, and if they are registered in another state, and they live out of state. So that is what the bill does. Mr. Speaker, I'll be glad to answer any questions, but if there are none, I will yield the well and ask
you. You have a question if you care to yield.
I will yield for a question.
Chair recognizes the chairman of the Transportation Committee, who's wide awake this afternoon.
Woke up there,
for a question.
Does the lady yield?
Yeah, the lady will yell. I'm sure you want to know where you can sign up for a massage.
Yes, absolutely. The question is, when we allow these out-of-state massage therapists to come into our state, is there a reciprocal agreement with those states that ours can go there as well?
I really do not know the answer to that. I'm sorry, Representative. No, I'm more concerned about our coast and our special places like the cloisters and other places along the coast being able to handle our tourists. Sorry.
Thank you. No,
it's okay. Mr. Speaker, if there are no other questions, I'll...
There are other questions, but it's up to you.
Thank you. I'll take one more and then I'll yield.
Chair recognizes the chair of the House Judiciary Committee, Chairman Willard, to your right for a question.
Thank you. The lady yield, please.
Yes, sir.
Madam, would this encourage someone like Nurse Cratchit to go receive some counseling for her bad bedside manner?
Sorry, Representative Willard.
I said, would this encourage someone like Nurse Cratchit to go receive counseling for her bad bedside manner?
Yes, sir, it would, especially if she was taking care of you. Mr. Speaker, I yield the well and I ask for your... favorable consideration.
Lady has yielded the will. On the lady's motion that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 315, all those in favor will vote yes, those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine. On the lady's motion that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 315, the ayes are 136, the nays are 37. This House has agreed. Chair recognizes the governor's floor leader, Representative Nimmer, for a motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, I ask that the House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 359. House Bill 359.
Representative Nimmer has moved that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 359. The clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 359 by Representative Nimmer, 178. Bill being titled Act, being titled 44, laying disposition, unclaimed property. In your agree, disagree folders on your desk, the House passed version of House Bill 359, upper right hand corner, LC 343716 EC. Senate substitute. House Bill 359, which is subject to Representative Nimmer's motion, upper right-hand corner, LC 343867 ECS. Favorable vote on this motion will constitute final passage of this bill.
Chair recognizes Representative Nimmer to explain his motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, if I could remind you, on March the 5th, House Bill 359, I presented and you passed unanimously with a vote of 167-0. It made its way over to the Georgia State Senate, and in lieu of a Supreme Court ruling on March 19th while in the Senate, we found some language that we needed to put into this bill because it was germane to bring it back over and get some language clarification for us. And it is found in section one of the bill between lines 16 and 19. If you'll see those three words we've added there, they're underlined in the bill for legal malpractice. This just makes it in a right of action for personal torts, for legal malpractice, or for injuries arising from fraud to the assigner may not be assigned. Mr. Speaker, that is it. That is the amendment, the substitute to House Bill 359, and I'd ask for your favorable consideration.
You have some questions. Do you yield?
Yes, sir. I'll yield for one.
For just one?
Or two. However many you say, boss.
I wish all of my life were like that. Chair recognizes Representative Coomer to your right for a question.
The gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Nimmer, isn't it true that in the Supreme Court decision of First American Title Insurance Company versus Villanueva, that the Supreme Court decided to follow the precedent set in foreign jurisdictions and non-American jurisdictions?
That is correct.
And isn't it further, which further yield?
Yes, sir, I do.
Isn't it also true that the position taken by the Supreme Court is a position taken by a small minority of states in this country?
Yes.
Would you further yield?
Yes, sir.
Is it not further true that the position of the amendment is actually a position to protect the interests of clients and their privacy interests with their attorneys and also in consumers in Georgia?
Yes, sir, that is true.
Right, thank you very much.
Thank you, Representative.
Do you have another question if you care to yield?
Mr. Speaker, I know we've got a lot of business to take up, and no disrespect to anyone with a question, but I'm going to yield the well and ask for your favorable
consideration.
Gentleman
has yielded the well. On the gentleman's motion that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 359, all those in favor of the motion will vote aye, those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the gentleman's motion that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 359, the ayes are 173, the nays are zero. This House has agreed. Chair recognizes the governor's floor leader, Representative Coomer, for a motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move the House agree to Senate substitute House Bill 372 as amended by the House.
Representative Coomer has moved that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 372 as amended by this House. The clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 372 by Representative Coomer, the 14th. Bill to be entitled Act, amend Title 20 relating to education, revised eligibility of a HOPE grant. In your agree, disagree folders, you see the House passed version, House Bill 372, upper right hand corner, LC 343805S. The Senate substitute, House Bill 372, LC 410092S, and the amendment has been printed and placed on your desk by Representative Coomer. Representative Coomer, the 14th, and others offer the following amendment. Amend the Senate Higher Education Substitute, House Bill 372, the amendment AM 331361.
Chair recognizes Representative Coomer to explain his motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The motion is to remove language that was added to the bill in the Senate and to return the bill to its original purpose. You'll see the amendment is signed by the sponsors, the House sponsors of the bill, and we're asking that we return that language to its original language as we sent it out of here before. And I would say Representative Nimmer had no votes on that last bill. And I was trying to get up here quickly because I saw Representative Gregory had walked out, but now he's back. I don't know if I can get zero no votes, but Representative Gregory, I hope I can get zero no votes to match my roommate here. So thanks very much.
Gentleman has yielded the well. On the gentleman's motion that this House agree to the Senate substitute, House Bill 372 as amended by this House, all those in favor will vote yes, those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, called it? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the gentleman's motion that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 372 as amended by this House, the ayes are 176, the nays are 1. This House has agreed. House will come back to order. House will come back to order. Chair recognizes Representative Geisinger for a motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and ladies and gentlemen of the House. I move that the House agree to the amendment of House Resolution 4.
Representative Geisinger has moved that this House agree to the Senate amendment to House Resolution 4. The clerk will read the caption.
House Resolution 4 by Representative Geisinger, the 48th, resolution proposing settlement boundaries between the state of Georgia and the state of Tennessee. The House passed version, House Resolution 4 is printed. It's in your agree, disagree folders, upper right-hand corner, LC 2864-29. The Senate amendment to House Resolution 4, which is subject to Representative Geisinger's motion, printed in your folders, upper right-hand corner, AM281262.
Chair recognizes Representative Geisinger to explain his motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Senate amended the
House Resolution 4 and made it a bit stronger in regards to the action that should be taken if the Tennessee General Assembly does not take action at all, and simply says that if by the end of our regular session in 2014 no action has been taken, that the state of Georgia, the Attorney General, is authorized and directed to file suit in the United States Supreme Court. Mr. Speaker, if there are no questions, I yield the well.
Chair has a question.
Yes, sir.
If the courts don't settle it, the resolution doesn't provide for military incursion into the state of Tennessee by our National Guard, does it?
Not this week, sir.
Okay. Given where I live, I get a little nervous about these border wars up there. You have a question, a legitimate question, if you care
to
yield. I'm sure it'll be more legitimate than that one. Chair recognizes Representative Thomas to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Will the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
So when the resolution left the House, we were essentially saying, you know, we'd really like to work something out with you, state of Tennessee. Let's sit down. We'll get our governors together, our legislators together, and try and figure this out. Is that an accurate description?
It is, and it still is.
So will the gentleman further yield?
I do.
So the Senate version seems to be saying, we'd really like to get together and work this out. However, if we don't, we're going to sue you. Is that an accurate interpretation?
Well, based on the history of this legislation, that is since 1818 when the mistake was made, it's time for the state of Georgia to take some action.
Will the gentleman further yield?
I do.
Does this resolution actually require the Attorney General to take any action? It says that we are directing him to do so. Does this have the weight of law behind it?
This is the desire of the House and Senate of this body, of this building.
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, if there are no further questions, I yield the well.
There are no further questions.
Thank you.
Gentleman has yielded the well on the gentleman's motion that this House agree to the Senate amendment to House Resolution 4. All those in favor will vote yes, those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the gentleman's motion that this House agree to the Senate amendment to House Resolution 4, the ayes are 157, the nays are 13. This House has agreed. Thank you. Chair recognizes Chairman Willard for a motion. House will be in order. Chairman Willard.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to move for the House to insist on its position on Senate Bill 113 and appoint a committee, conference committee.
Well, we're insisting now, and then it'll go back, and we're a step away from appointing a committee. Chairman Willard has moved that the House insist on its position on Senate Bill 113. Clerk will read the caption.
Senate Bill 113 by Senator Jones of the 10th, bill of entitled Amendment Code Section 911-4, laying the process.
Chair recognizes Chairman Willard to explain his motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This deals with the issue of service of process, and I think the Senate has misunderstood some of the position we have in the bill and need to have them look at what we've done and try to make a decision, proper decision on it.
No questions. Chairman Willard has moved that this House insist on its position on Senate Bill 113. Is there objection? The chair hears none. The House has insisted on its position on Senate Bill 113. Chair recognizes Chairman Rice for a motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that the House insist on its position on Senate Bill 121.
Clerk will read the caption.
Senate Bill 121 by Senator Ramsey of the 43rd, a bill of entitlement, Title 40, laying the prestige license plates and special plates for certain persons and vehicles.
Chair recognizes Chairman Rice to explain his motion.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is just a little disagreement over some tags we have in play over there, and I think we can get it worked out in the conference in a few minutes. I just ask you to agree that we get the opportunity to talk to him about it.
Chairman Rice has moved that this House insist on its position on Senate Bill 121. Is there objection? The chair hears none, and this House has insisted on its position on Senate Bill 121. Chair recognizes Representative Coomer for a motion.
Mr. Speaker, I move the House insist on its position, Senate Bill 137.
Representative Coomer has moved that this House insist on its position on Senate Bill 137. The clerk will read the caption.
Senate Bill 137, a bill being titled Amendment Code Section 4870.40.1, relating tax credits for business enterprises in less developed areas. What?
Chair recognizes Representative Coomer to explain his motion.
Senate Bill 137 was passed out yesterday morning. It simply adds the Commissioner of Economic Development to the approval process for economic opportunity zones, and we need to insist on our position. Thanks.
Governor's floor leader, Representative Coomer, has moved that this House insist on its position on Senate Bill 137. Is there objection? The chair hears none, and the House has insisted on its position. Chair recognizes Representative Hightower for a motion.
Mr. Speaker, I move the House insist on its position on House substitute to SB 160.
Representative Hightower has moved that this House insist on its position on Senate Bill 160. The clerk will read the caption.
Senate Bill 160 by Senator Ginn on the 47th, a bill being entitled Act, Amendment Code Section 131091 relating to verification of employee eligibility, applicability, rules and regulations provided for an annual report made by public employers.
Chair recognizes Representative Hightower to explain his motion.
Mr. Speaker, there's a disagreement as to the proper language that needs to be entailed in this bill. I believe we can figure it out if we go to conference.
Representative Hightower has moved that this House insist on its position on Senate Bill 160. Is there objection? The chair hears none. This House has insisted on its position on Senate Bill 160. Chair recognizes Chairman Coleman for a motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members of the House, I move that the House accept the substitute to House Bill 283, the Senate substitute to House 283 as amended by the House.
Chairman Coleman has moved that this House agree to the Senate amendment to the Senate substitute to House Bill 283 as amended by this House. The clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 283 by Representative Coleman, 97th. The bill will be entitled Amendment Title 20 relating to education. In your agree-disagree folders, you'll find the Senate substitute, House Bill 283, upper right-hand corner, HB 283/SCSFA/2, and the amendment offered by Representative Coleman and others, printed and placed on your desk. Amend the Senate substitute, House Bill 283, the amendment referred to by Representative Coleman, printed on your desk, upper right-hand corner, AM 331359.
Chair recognizes Chairman Coleman to explain his motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members of the House, you have two documents before you on your desk. If you'll look at, put them side by side, and that's the Senate substitute to 283 and also the amendment that we placed on your desk. What happened, the Senate on 283 made several changes in the Senate to our House bill. And you remember the House bill 283 was the Title 20, the second phase of the QB Study Commission's cleanup of Title 20 language. We had about 30 sections of Title 20 we were adding to, revising, deleting. And so I would like to, if I could, just to go over the sections that they changed. Basically what they did in Section 2, it declares that the Board of Education, Section 3 and 4, we had a second phase of this QB Study Commission. We were going to do an equalization and a flexibility and an accountability bill that the Senate is holding up. And so by doing that, we had to go in there, and in Section 3 and 4, we have school systems that are either charter systems right now, they can be IE squared systems, or they can just be standalone school systems still under state control. If we had not made these changes in that section, allowing the IE square schools, because in our bill that did not move, we were going to take care of this, we had to just give them until the end of their five-year period where they would not have to renew their contract. That's just extending their IE square contract for about 6 months to take care of that. Another change to that bill was in Section 10. We had proposed that in charter systems, in the budget, they have, if a system goes into charter system, they get $100 per child. And we had proposed that $100, and that's forever, as long as they're in that charter system. We had proposed in the House that $100 be a one-time grant, and that's it. Well, what they're proposing, they just said, let's keep that grant there, but let's, because what was going to happen in school systems like Fulton County or Gwinnett, that could amount to $10, $12 million. So what they did, they amended that to say that that would be capped at a $4.5 million grant. They disagreed with us with doing away with it. They wanted to keep it and say that the maximum would be a $4.5 million grant. Another change was in the section 14. What we did there, basically the last part of that section,
there was a problem with charter schools, the charter schools when they were next to each other. We were interpreting the word contiguous, meaning about school systems and grades. The State Department of Education was interpreting that to mean like first grade, second grade, third grade, fourth grade. We had a charter school that was in the city of Atlanta that had a building that was on one campus, and about 3 or 4 miles away they had another building. They were not allowing us to have a principal for each school because they were saying they were not contiguous. So that's just defining what contiguous means there so that we can place principals on both of those schools. Section 23, there was a little change. Now listen to this one. There was concern about the homeschoolers. We corrected that now. The only thing this is doing, it says that if a person is homeschooling their children, they will file a one-time application that they will homeschool them, and then each year they will electronically report the attendance, that they attended school. But the biggest thing it does, it allows that homeschool parent to sign a document that allows their child to get a driver's license. In the past, they've had to come to the school, to the State Department, because you know we have a law that says you have to be in school at 16 to get your driver's license. That's what that does. If you look at Section 28, now Section 28 deals with pre-K and charter schools. We have added on this amendment that's on your desk, if you look at line 10 of the amendment, what that basically does is that says that pre-K kindergartens that are located on a campus that's a charter school, they have priority to get into that charter school when they move out of the pre-K class. Section 30, there was a change, and that's just simply saying that's promoting school-level governance. In the charter system that the Senate has, that schools may choose to be a charter system, it says if you receive that money, you must operate at the school level basis. You must have a parent council. You must allow your principals and teachers to be involved and not be a top-down superintendent down. And that's just specifying what happens if you don't do that. You can lose your charter and you can lose your money. And Section 32, there's a change. That's the office of the Governor's Office of Student Achievement. That also goes along, ladies and gentlemen, and I like this one, with this amendment here. And what that does on line 14, it says they can create an office that will have a foundation to receive public and corporate funds in order to help failing and schools and to reward schools that want to try new and innovative activities. And what this does, this just opens up a section so that the governor in his budget can appropriate public funds to this foundation so that public schools can receive money just like some of these private schools. So that's a foundation to allow corporations and the governor and for us to allot money to this foundation to help schools that are failing and also to reward schools. Now in this bill, now listen, this is where I want you to pay attention. The next section, 33A we're adding to this bill, and we had a Senate Bill 243 that was providing transparency. There's been some real concern about the student scholarship, the Qualified Education Tax Credit Scholarship, and about the student scholarship organizations. We wanted more transparency. They were concerned, so they sent a Senate bill over to do this. Also, we wanted to cap that organization because they had an escalator in that one that allowed that amount to increase year after year. So we want to try to eliminate that escalator and also to have the transparency. We also wanted to have an audit. We wanted to cut administrative cost in that and have more money for these scholarships. So that's what this bill did. But since there is a cap that became a fiscal note, we needed to attach it to a House bill because a fiscal note has to originate in the House, so that's what this is doing. So if you look at your amendment there on your desk, what this is basically doing, if you look at the bottom of it, starting at line 22-23, it's saying, it's defining what a student is, what these students are, and what the program is. If you look over on the second page of this one, on like lines 42, 40, rather lines 36 through line 40, it's talking about how students can qualify that. We're straightening that up. They've got to be enrolled in schools for 6 weeks, or either they've got to be in from a low-performing school. They've got to be have been in a school where there's been a lot of bullying, or that school has been accused of having a lot of bullying going on, or they are homeschooled children. They don't have to be enrolled in the school to get this scholarship. Look at Section 47. This is one I'm proud of. In Section 47, in the past, 10% of all the money that was contributed went to operation costs. In this one, if the scholarship organization is less than $1.5 million, they can charge 10% for administration. But as it goes up to 1.5 to 10 million, 93% of that money has to go for scholarships. If it goes up to 10 to 20 million, 95% of the money must go for scholarships. So it's defining how the money can be used there, and that more money will go to the scholarships. On page 4, it's talking about the transparency, again, dealing with transparency, talking about the audit. The audit will be done by the Department of Revenue. These audits will be posted. It'll be there for what for people can see, the students that have gotten the scholarships, and they may, you know, talk about the needs based on that also. Basically, what it's doing is adding transparency to this, organization, and it's the thing we've been wanting. Now, one thing it is doing, I want you to look on page 6. What it's doing, it's capping for the first time, capping these organizations. If you look on page 6 at line 202, it's capping them at $65 million. That's the cap. And it's taking out the escalator where they won't increase every year. That's the, what it's doing there. And this is basically what the bill does. Mr. Speaker, that is the bill, and I encourage you to please work with me, and let's agree to the Senate substitute as amended by the House.
You picked up a few questions along the way.
I expected.
Do you yield?
I will yield for a couple of questions, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes the Minority Caucus Whip, Representative Hughley, to your left for a question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, ma'am.
This is quite a Christmas tree, wouldn't you agree?
Well,
Real question.
The only thing that's been really added to it has been this last piece. Yes, ma'am.
Real question. On the amendment?
The amendment, yes, ma'am.
On lines 36 to 41, how is the Office of Student Achievement going to document that these students have come from these areas? What is going to be shown, and how will the public know that these students have actually come from a system where there's bullying, as you say, or physical violence?
Well, because, as you know, I mentioned to you when we were talking about the flexibility and accountability bill, we're developing this report card that the state has, and we'll be grading schools with the 21 indicators. And in these indicators, it talks about low-performing schools. They get a grade from 1 to 100. They'll know that. And based on the audit, they'll know where these children are coming from, the ones that have applied, so that's how they'll know it, by the report card they get.
Further question.
Yes, ma'am.
Are you saying then that as part of their application, that certification from the Office of Student Achievement will be part of the application that these students send?
That will be the information they'll have that they can report out. In other words, they'll still operate as a habit. They'll report out where these students came from, and if they were from low-performing schools, or if they do not come from a low-performing school, or they're not from a bullying school, or from a home school, they must have been enrolled 6 weeks in their other school.
Another question for you.
Yes, ma'am. I'll take one more.
Would you speak to why we are adding more money than these organizations would have gotten if the escalator had just stayed in place? We're adding 10 times as much as they would have gotten.
Well, not quite
true?
10 times, but if the escalator stays in place, it will continually go, and you know it compounds itself. If it goes to 55, then it's a percentage of that the next year. So it was felt that the governor's office met with the group, and they decided they'd put a cap on it where they thought it would be, and that's why, because the escalator was taken off so that it won't increase.
So if you don't agree that it's 10 times, what's the difference between what they would have gone to this year and what we're
trying to do? Well, I don't have my calculator here, but I think it would have been about 55 next year, right?
So we're going up about 10.
Okay.
Chair recognizes Chairman Earhart to your right for a question.
Yes, sir.
Gentlemen, yield.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it true that this particular piece of legislation now has significant transparency and reporting requirements in it?
That, to me, that's one of the best parts of this amendment and this bill. It has complete transparency and reporting requirements that are very spelled out very specifically.
And isn't it finally true that we owe this governor a debt of gratitude for his leadership on this, for his ability to make sure that not everyone got everything they wanted, but it's a very balanced approach to this issue, and we should thank him for that.
You know, I think that's true, the fact that not everybody got what they want, not everybody got as much as they want, but it was a good compromise. And the part I like that I pointed out to you earlier is that public school component in there, something that we wanted. Public schools are now going to get something appropriated by the governor and that businesses can give. Do I have another?
Chair recognizes the governor's floor leader. Representative Nimmer to your left for a question.
Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
Chairman Coleman, is it not true that you just alluded to, and I agree with the fact that there's been a lot of discussions and a lot of compromise putting this bill together?
You better believe it, a lot of it.
You further yield?
Yes, sir.
Is it not true that I 100% support the fact that we've got detailed transparency in this bill for this organization that we fund?
Yes, sir. That's one of the high points of the amendment in the bill.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you. So, Mr. Speaker, I think everybody knows what they're going to do, and I think I will yield the well.
Gentleman has yielded the well. On the gentleman's motion that this House agree to the Senate substitute to House Bill 283 as amended by this House, all those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the gentleman's motion, the ayes are 119, the nays are 48. This House has agreed to the Senate substitute to House Bill 283 as amended by this House. Chair recognizes Chairman Cooper. Chair recognizes Chairman Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. When we have a break, I would like to see the members of the Health and Human Services Committee in the anteroom for just a minute, please. The Health and Human Services Committee. Thank you.
They can start gathering momentarily. Chair recognizes the Chairman of the Rules Committee for an announcement.
Love it when you're loved. Ladies and gentlemen, there will be a Rules Committee meeting today at 4:15, room 341. Thank you.
House will be in recess until 4:30 p.m. this afternoon.